Read and Be Wise, A New Battledore by an Unknown Author. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Ruth Golding. Read and Be Wise, A New Battledore by an Unknown Author.
A. Almanac, will you buy an almanac?
B.
Buy a broom, mop, brush or hair broom.
C.
Chairs to mend, old chairs to mend.
D.
Dust ho, bring out your dust.
E.
Eels, live eels, large silver eels.
F.
Fowls, live fowl or fat chicken.
G.
Great news in the London Gazette.
H.
Hot spiced gingerbread, all hot.
I.
Images, very fine, very pretty.
K.
Knives to grind or scissors to grind.
L.
Lobster, buy my live lobster.
M.
Milk below maids, milk from the cow.
N.
Newcastle salmon, delicate salmon.
O.
Oars or sculler, have a boat.
P.
Potatoes £2 for a penny.
Q.
Quack doctors vend variety of medicines.
R.
Rabbit, oh, rabbit, fine fat rabbit.
S.
Sweet foot, ho, sweet for your foot.
T.
Tea kettle or pots to mend.
V.
Files or bottles to sell. Any broken flint glass.
W.
Walnuts, rare cracking walnuts.
X.
Buy a box, bonnet or a lockbox.
Y.
Yorkshire cakes, muffin or crumpet.
Z.
Zealand or England and a map of the world.
End of Read and Be Wise, A New Battledore. Recording by Ruth Golding.
Peter Piper's Practical Principles of Plain and Perfect Pronunciation. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, visit LibriVox.org. Peter Piper's Practical Principles of Plain and Perfect Pronunciation by an anonymous author. Preface. Peter Piper, without pretension to precocity or profoundness, puts pen to paper to produce these puzzling pages, purposely to please the palates of pretty prattling playfellows, proudly presuming that with proper penetration it will probably, and perhaps positively, prove a peculiarly pleasant and profitable path to proper, plain, and precise pronunciation. He prays parents to purchase this playful performance, partly to pay him for his patience and pains, partly to provide for the printers and publishers, but principally to prevent the pernicious prevalence of perverse pronunciation. A. Andrew Airpump asked his aunt her ailment. Did Andrew Airpump ask his aunt her ailment? If Andrew Airpump asked his aunt her ailment, where was the ailment of Andrew Airpump's aunt? B. Billy Button bought a buttered biscuit. Did Billy Button buy a buttered biscuit? If Billy Button bought a buttered biscuit, where's the buttered biscuit Billy Button bought? C. Captain Crackskull cracked a catchpaw's coxcomb. Did Captain Crackskull crack a catchpaw's coxcomb? If Captain Catskull cracked a catchpaw's coxcomb, where's the catchpaw's coxcomb Captain Crackskull cracked? D. Davy Doldrum dreamed he drove a dragon. Did Davy Doldrum dream he drove a dragon? If Davy Doldrum dreamed he drove a dragon, where's the dragon Davy Doldrum dreamed he drove? E. Enoch Elkrig ate an empty eggshell. Did Enoch Elkrig eat an empty eggshell? If Enoch Elkrig ate an empty eggshell, where's the empty eggshell Enoch Elkrig ate? F. Francis Fribble figured on a Frenchman's filly. Did Francis Fribble figure on a Frenchman's filly? If Francis Fribble figured on a Frenchman's filly, where's the Frenchman's filly Francis Fribble figured on? G. Gaffer Gilpin got a goose and gander. Did Gaffer Gilpin get a goose and gander? If Gaffer Gilpin got a goose and gander, where's the goose and gander Gaffer Gilpin got? H. Humphrey Hunchback had 100 hedgehogs. Did Humphrey Hunchback have 100 hedgehogs? If Humphrey Hunchback had 100 hedgehogs, where's the 100 hedgehogs Humphrey Hunchback had? I. Inigo Impey itched for an Indian image. Did Inigo Impey itch for an Indian image? If Inigo Impey itched for an Indian image, where's the Indian image Inigo Impey itched for? J. Jumping Jackie jeered a jesting juggler. Did Jumping Jackie jeer a jesting juggler? If Jumping Jackie jeered a jesting juggler, where's the jesting juggler Jumping Jackie jeered? K. Kimbo Kemble kicked his kinsman's kettle. Did Kimbo Kemble kick his kinsman's kettle? If Kimbo Kemble kicked his kinsman's kettle, where's the kinsman's kettle Kimbo Kemble kicked? L. Lanky Lawrence lost his lass and lobster. Did Lanky Lawrence lose his lass and lobster? If Lanky Lawrence lost his lass and lobster, where are the lass and lobster Lanky Lawrence lost? M. Matthew Menlegs missed a mangled monkey. Did Matthew Menlegs miss a mangled monkey? If Matthew Menlegs missed a mangled monkey, where is the mangled monkey Matthew Menlegs missed? N. Neddy Noodle nipped his neighbor's nutmegs. Did Neddy Noodle nip his neighbor's nutmegs? If Neddy Noodle nipped his neighbor's nutmegs, where are the neighbor's nutmegs Neddy Noodle nipped? O. Oliver Oglethorpe ogled an owl and oyster. Did Oliver Oglethorpe ogle an owl and oyster? If Oliver Oglethorpe ogled an owl and oyster, where are the owl and oyster Oliver Oglethorpe ogled? P. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. Did Peter Piper pick a peck of pickled peppers? If Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers, where's the peck of pickled peppers Peter Piper picked? Q. Quixote Quicksight quizzed a queerish quidbox. Did Quixote Quicksight quiz a queerish quidbox? If Quixote Quicksight quizzed a queerish quidbox. Where's the queerish quidbox Quixote Quickside quizzed? R. Rory Rumpus rode a raw-boned racehorse. Did Rory Rumpus ride a raw-boned racehorse? If Rory Rumpus rode a raw-boned racehorse, where's the raw-boned racehorse Rory Rumpus rode? S. Sammy Smelly smelt a smell of small coal. Did Sammy Smelly smell a smelt of small coal? If Sammy Smelly smelt a smell of small coal, where's the smell of small coal Sammy Smelly smelt? T. Tiptoe Tommy turned a Turk for twopence. Did Tiptoe Tommy turn a Turk for twopence? If Tiptoe Tommy turned a Turk for twopence, where's the Turk for twopence Tiptoe Tommy turned? U. Uncle's Usher urged an ugly urchin. Did Uncle's Usher urge an ugly urchin? If Uncle's Usher urged an ugly urchin, where's the ugly urchin Uncle's Usher urged? V. William Veedon viped his wig and vase-coat. Did William Veedon vipe his wig and vase-coat? If William Veedon viped his wig and vase-coat, where are the wig and vase-coat William Veedon viped? W. Walter Waddle won a walking wager. Did Walter Waddle win a walking wager? If Walter Waddle won a walking wager, where's the walking wager Walter Waddle won? XYZ. X, Y, and Z have made my brains to cracko. X smokes, Y snuffs, and Z chews tobacco. Yet oft by X, Y, Z much learning's taught. But Peter Piper beats them all to naught. A hymn. I'm not too young for God to see. He knows my name and nature too. And all day long he looks at me and sees my actions through and through. He listens to the words I say and knows the thoughts I have within. And whether I'm at work or play, he's sure to see me if I sin. Oh, how could children tell a lie, or cheat in play, or steal, or fight, if they remembered God was by and had them always in his sight? If some good minister is near, it makes us careful what we do, and how much more ought we to fear the Lord who sees us through and through. Then, when I want to do amiss, however pleasant it may be, I'll always try to think of this. I'm not too young for God to see. End of Peter Piper's Practical Principles of Plain and Perfect Pronunciation. Read by Denny Sayers for LibriVox, Modesto, California.
A Nonsense Alphabet by Edward Lear. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. A Nonsense Alphabet by Edward Lear. A. A was once an apple pie. Pidey, widey, tidy, pidey. Nice insidey apple pie. B. B was once a little bear. Beary, weary, hairy, beary, takey, carey, little bear. C. C was once a little cake. Cakey, bakey, makey, cakey, takey, cakey, little cake. D. D was once a little doll. Dolly, Molly, Polly, Nolly, Nursey, Dolly, little doll. E. E was once a little eel. Eely, weely, peely, eely, twirly, tweely, little eel. F. F was once a little fish. Fishy, wishy, squishy, fishy, in a dishy, little fish. G. G was once a little goose. Goosey, moosey, boosey, goosey, waddly, woosey, little goose. H. H was once a little hen. Henny, chenny, tenny, henny, eggsy, enny, little hen. I was once a bottle of ink. Inky, dinky, stinky, inky, blacky, minky, bottle of ink. J. J was once a jar of jam. Jammy, mammy, clammy, jammy, sweety, swammy, jar of jam. K. K was once a little kite. Kitey, whitey, flighty, kitey, out of sighty, little kite. L. L was once a little lark. Larky, marky, harky, larky, in the parky, little lark. M. M was once a little mouse. Mousy, bousy, sousy, mousy, in the housey, little mouse. N. N was once a little needle. Needly, tweedly, threadly, needly, whisky, weedly, little needle. O. O was once a little owl. Owly, prowly, howly, owly, browny, fowly, little owl. P. P was once a little pump. Pumpy, slumpy, flumpy, pumpy, dumpy, thumpy, little pump. Q. Q was once a little quail. Quaily, faily, daily, quaily, stumpy, taily, little quail. R. R was once a little rose. Rosy, posy, nosy, rosy, blowsy, grosy, little rose. S. S was once a little shrimp. Shrimpy, nimpy, flimpy, shrimpy, jumpy, jimpy, little shrimp. T. T was once a little thrush. Thrushy, hushy, bushy, thrushy, flitty, flushy, little thrush. U. U was once a little urn. Urny, burny, turny, urny, bubbly, burny, little urn. V. V was once a little vine. Viney, whiny, twiny, viney, twisty, twiny, little vine. W. W was once a whale. Whaley, scaly, shaly, whaley, tumbly, taily, mighty whale. X. X was once a great King Xerxes. Xerxy, perxy, turxy, xerxy, linksy, lurksy, great King Xerxes. Y. Y was once a little U. Udy, feudy, crudy, udy, grody, grudy, little U. Z. Z was once a piece of zinc. Tinky, winky, blinky, tinky, tinkly, minky, piece of zinc. End of alphabet.
A moral alphabet. In words of from 1 to 7 syllables. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, visit LibriVox.org. This reading is by Denny Sayers. A Moral Alphabet in Words of from 1 to 7 Syllables by Hilaire Belloc. A stands for Archibald, who told no lies, and got this lovely volume for a prize. The upper school had combed and oiled their hair, and all the parents of the boys were there. In words that ring like thunder through the hall, draw tears from some and loud applause from all. The pedagogue, with pardonable joy, bestows the gift upon the radiant boy. "Except the noblest work produced as yet," says he, "upon the English alphabet. Next term I shall examine you, to find if you have read it thoroughly. So mind." And while the boys and parents cheered so loud that out of doors a large and anxious crowd had gathered and was blocking up the street, the admirable child resumed his seat. Moral: learn from this justly irritating youth to brush your hair and teeth and tell the truth. B stands for bear. When bears are seen approaching in the distance, make up your mind at once between retreat and armed resistance. A gentleman remained to fight. With what result for him? The bear, with ill-concealed delight, devoured him, limb by limb. Another person turned and ran away. He ran extremely hard. The bear was faster than the man, and beat him by a yard. Moral: decisive action in the hour of need denotes the hero, but does not succeed. C stands for cobra. When the cobra bites an Indian judge, the judge spends restless nights. Moral: this creature, though disgusting and appalling, conveys no kind of moral worth recalling. D for dreadful, the dreadful Dinotherium. He will have to do his best for D. The early world observed with awe his back indented like a saw. His look was gay, his voice was strong, his tail was neither short nor long. His trunk, or elongated nose, was not so large as some suppose. His teeth, as all the world allows, were graminivorous like a cow's. He therefore should have wished to pass long peaceful nights upon the grass, but being mad, the brute preferred to roost in branches like a bird. We have good reason to suppose he did so from his claw-like toes. A creature heavier than a whale, you see at once, could hardly fail to suffer badly when he slid and tumbled, as he always did. His fossil, therefore, comes to light all broken up, and serve him right. Moral: if you were born to walk the ground, remain there, do not fool around. E for egg. E stands for egg. Moral: the moral of this verse is applicable to the young. Be terse. F for family. F for a family, taking a walk in Arcadia Terrace, no doubt. The parents indulge in intelligent talk, while the children, they gambol about. At a quarter past six, they return to their tea, of a kind that would hardly be tempting to me, though my appetite passes belief. There is jam, ginger beer, buttered toast, marmalade, with a cold leg of mutton, and warm lemonade, and a large pigeon pie, very skillfully made, to consist almost wholly of beef. Moral: a respectable family taking the air is a subject on which I could dwell. It contains all the morals that ever there were, and it sets an example as well. G for new. G stands for new, whose weapons of defense are long, sharp, curling horns, and common sense. To these he adds a name so short and strong that even hardy boors pronounce it wrong. How often on a bright autumnal day the pious people of Pretoria say, "Come, let us hunt thee." Then no more is heard but sounds of strong men struggling with a word. Meanwhile, the distant mew, with grateful eyes, observes his opportunity and flies. Moral: child, if you have a rummy kind of name, remember to be thankful for the same. H for Horseman. H was a horseman who rode to the meet, and talked of the pads of the fox as his feet, an error which furnished subscribers with grounds for refusing to make him a master of hounds. He gave way thereupon to so fearful a rage that he sold up his stable and went on the stage, and had all the success that a man could desire in creating the part of the old English squire. Moral: in the learned professions, a person should know the advantage of having two strings to his bow. I for Indian. I, the poor Indian, justly called the poor, he has to eat his dinner off the floor. Moral: the moral these delightful lines afford is, living cheaply is its own reward. J for James. J stands for James, who thought it immaterial to pay his taxes, local or imperial. In vain the mother wept, the wife implored. James only yawned as though a trifle bored. The tax collector called again, but he was met with persiflage and repartee. When James was hauled before the learned judge, who lectured him, he loudly whispered, "Fudge!" The judge was startled from his usual calm. He struck the desk before him with his palm, and roared in tones to make the boldest quail. J stands for James, it also stands for jail. And therefore, on a dark and dreadful day, policemen came and took him all away. Moral: the fate of James is typical and shows how little mercy people can expect who will not pay their taxes, saving those to which they conscientiously object. K for Klondike. K for the Klondike. A country of gold, where the winters are often excessively cold, where the lawn every morning is covered with rime, and skating continues for years at a time. Do you think that a climate can conquer the grit of the sons of the West? Not a bit, not a bit. When the weather looks nippy, the bold pioneers put on two pairs of stockings and cover their ears, and roam through the dear Hyperborean dales with a vast apparatus of buckets and pails, or wander through wild Hyperborean glades with hoes, hammers, pickaxes, matlocks, and spades. There are some who give rise to exuberant mirth by turning up nothing but bushels of earth, while those who have little cause excellent fun by attempting to pilfer from those who have none. At times the reward they will get for their pains is to strike very tempting auriferous veins, or a shaft being sunk for some miles in the ground, not infrequently nuggets of value are found. They bring us the gold when their labors are ended, and we, after thanking them prettily, spend it. Moral: J Just you work for humanity. Never you mind if humanity seems to have left you behind. L for Lady. L was a lady, advancing in age, who drove in her carriage and six, with a couple of footmen, a coachman, and page, who were all of them regular bricks. If the coach ran away, or was smashed by a dray, or got into collisions and blocks, the page, with a courtesy rare for his years, would leap to the ground with inspiriting cheers, while the footman allayed her legitimate fears, and the coachman sat tight on his box. At night, as they met round an excellent meal, they would take it in turn to observe, "What a lady, indeed! What a presence to feel! What a woman to worship and serve!" But perhaps the most poignant of all their delights was to stand in a rapturous dream when she spoke to them kindly on Saturday nights and said they deserved her esteem. Moral. Now, observe the reward of these dutiful lives. At the end of their loyal career, they each had a lodge at the end of the drives, and she left them 100 a year. Remember from this to be properly vexed when the newspaper editors say that the type of society shown in the text is rapidly passing away. M for Millionaire. M was a millionaire who sat at table and ate like this as long as he was able. At 12:30, the waiters turned him out. He lived impoverished and died of gout. Moral. Disgusting exhibition. Have a care when, later on, you are a millionaire, to rise from table feeling you could still take something more and not be really ill. N for Ned. N stands for Ned, Maria's younger brother, who, walking one day, chose to gaze the other. In Blandford Square, a crowded part of town, two people, on a tandem, knocked him down. Whereat a motor car, with warning shout, ran right on top and turned him inside out. The damages that he obtained from these maintained him all his life in cultured ease. Moral. The law protects you. Go your gentle way. The other man has always got to pay. O for Oxford. O stands for Oxford. Hail, salubrious seat of learning, academical retreat, home of my middle age, malarial spot, which people call medieval, though it's not. The marshes in the neighborhood can vie with Cambridge, but the town itself is dry, and serves to make a kind of fold or pen, wherein to herd a lot of learned men. Were I to write but half of what they know, it would exhaust the space reserved for O, and as my book must not be over big, I turn at once to P, which stands for pig. Moral. Be taught by this to speak with moderation of places where, with decent application, one gets a good, sound, middle-class education. P for pig. P stands for pig, as I remarked before, a second cousin to the huge wild boar. But pigs are civilized, while huge wild boars live savagely, at random, out of doors, and in their coarse contempt for dainty foods, subsist on truffles, which they find in woods. Not so the cultivated pig, who feels the need of several courses at his meals, but wrongly thinks it does not matter whether he takes them one by one or all together. Hence pigs devour, from lack of self-respect, what epicures would certainly reject. Moral: learn from the pig to take whatever fate or elder persons heap upon your plate. Q for quinine. Q for quinine, which children take with jam and little bits of cake. Moral: how idiotic! Can quinine replace cold baths and sound hygiene? R for reviewer. R, the reviewer, reviewing my book, at which he had barely intended to look, but the very first lines upon A were enough to convince him the verses were excellent stuff. So he wrote, without stopping, for several days, in terms of extreme but well-merited praise. To quote but one passage, "No person," says he, "will be really content without purchasing three, while a parent will send for a dozen or more, and strew them about on the nursery floor. The versification might call for some strictures, were it not for its singular wit, while the pictures, though the handling of line is a little defective, make up amply in verve what they lack in perspective." Moral: the habit of constantly telling the truth will lend an additional luster to youth. S for snail. S stands for snail, who, though he be the least, is not an uninstructive, horned beast. His eyes are on his horns, and when you shout or tickle them, the horns go in and out. Had Providence seen proper to endow the furious unicorn or sober cow with such a gift, the one would never now appear so commonplace on coats of arms. And what a fortune for our failing farms if circus managers, with wealth untold, would take the cows for half their weight in gold. Moral: learn from the snail to take reproof with patience, and not put out your horns on all occasions. T for tourist. T for the genial tourist, who resides in Peckham, where he writes Italian guides. Moral: learn from this information not to cavil at slight mistakes in books on foreign travel. U for upas tree. U for the upas tree that casts a blight on those that pull their sister's hair and fight. But, oh, the good, they wander undismayed, and, as the subtle artist has portrayed, dispend the golden hours at play beneath its shade. A friend of mine, a botanist, believes that good can even browse upon its leaves. I doubt it. Moral: dear reader, if you chance to catch a sight of upas trees, betake yourself to flight. V for volunteer. V for the unobtrusive volunteer who fills the armies of the world with fear. Moral: seek with the volunteer to put aside the empty pomp of military pride. W for water beetle. My little victim, let me trouble you to fix your active mind on W. The water beetle here shall teach a sermon far beyond your reach. He flabbergasts the human race by gliding on the water's face with ease, celerity, and grace. but if he ever stopped to think of how he did it, he would sink. Moral: don't ask questions. X for nothing. No reasonable little child expects a grown-up man to make a rhyme on X. Moral: these verses teach a clever child to find excuse for doing all that he's inclined. Y for youth. Y stands for youth. It would have stood for yak, but that I wrote about him 2 years back. Youth is the pleasant springtime of our days, as Dante so mellifluously says, who always speaks of youth with proper praise. You have not got to youth, but when you do, you'll find what he and I have said is true. Moral: youth's excellence should teach the modern wit first to be young, and then to boast of it. Z stands for Zeboo. Z for this Zeboo, who, like all Zeboos, is held divine by scrupulous Hindus. Von Kettner writes it Zeboo. Worst, Zeboo. I split the difference and use the two. Moral: idolatry, as you are well aware, is highly reprehensible. But there, we needn't bother. When we get to Z, our interest in the alphabet is dead. End of A Moral Alphabet. Read for LibriVox by Denny Sayers in Modesto, California. Fall 2008.
A Nonsense Alphabet by Edward Lear. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. A Nonsense Alphabet by Edward Lear. A. A was an ape who stole some white tape and tied up his toes in four beautiful bows. A. Funny old ape. B. B was a bat who slept all the day and fluttered about when the sun went away. B. Brown little bat. C. C was a camel, you rode on his hump, and if you fell off you came down such a bump. C. What a high camel. D. D was a dove who lived in a wood with such pretty soft wings and so gentle and good. D. Dear little dove. E. E was an eagle who sat on the rocks and looked down on the fields and the faraway flocks. E. Beautiful eagle. F. F was a fan made of beautiful stuff, and when it was used it went puffy puff puff. F. Nice little fan. G. G was a gooseberry perfectly red to be made into jam and eaten with bread. G. Gooseberry red. H. H was a heron who stood in a stream. The length of his neck and his legs was extreme. H. Long-legged heron. I. I was an inkstand which stood on a table, with a nice pen to write with when we are able. I. Neat little inkstand. J. J was a jug so pretty and white, with fresh water in it at morning and night. J. Nice little jug. K. K was a kingfisher, quickly he flew, so bright and so pretty, green, purple and blue. K. Kingfisher blue. L. L was a lily, so white and so sweet, to see it and smell it was quite a nice treat. L. Beautiful lily. M. M was a man who walked round and round, and he wore a long coat that came down to the ground. M. Funny old man. N. N was a nut so smooth and so brown, and when it was ripe, it fell tumble-dum down. N. Nice little nut. O. O was an oyster who lived in his shell. If you left him alone, he felt perfectly well. O. Open-mouthed oyster. P. P was a polly, all red, blue and green, the most beautiful polly that ever was seen. P. Poor little polly. Q. Q was a quill made into a pen, but I do not know where and I cannot say when. Q. Nice little quill. R. R was a rattlesnake, rolled up so tight, those who saw him ran quickly for fear he should bite. R. Rattlesnake bite. S. S was a screw to screw down a box, and then it was fastened without any locks. S. Valuable screw. T. T was a thimble of silver so bright, when placed on the finger it fitted so tight. T. Nice little thimble. U. U was an upper coat, woolly and warm, to wear over all in the snow or a storm. U. What a nice upper coat. V. V was a veil with a border upon it, and a ribbon to tie it all round a pink bonnet. V. Pretty green veil. W. W was a watch where, in letters of gold, the hours of the day you might always behold. W. Beautiful watch. X. X was King Xerxes, who wore on his head a mighty large turban, green, yellow, and red. X. Look at King Xerxes. Y. Y was a yak from the land of Tibet. Except his white tail, he was all black as jet. Y. Look at the yak. Z. Z was a zebra, all striped white and black, and if he were tame, you might ride on his back. Z. Pretty striped zebra. End of alphabet.
Alphabet of Fruits. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, visit LibriVox.org. This reading by Denny Sayers. Alphabet of Fruits, by an anonymous author, published in the series Aunt Louise's London Toy Books. A is for apples, so rosy and round, which the children delight to pick up from the ground. B for the blackberry, open to all, to the rich and the poor, to cottage and hall. C is for currants, which Dora, you see, is picking for tarts from the red currant tree. D for the damsons we make into jam, which is often, in Germany, eaten with ham. E for the elder, with berries so brown, you may sell them for tuppence a quart in the town. F for the fig, which in Italy grows, all temptingly laid in a basket in rows. G for the grapes, which, beside the swift Rhine, the peasant girls gather to make into wine. H is the hazelnut, found in the copse, where the squirrel from branch to branch playfully hops. I, ivy berries, both purple and blue. You may not think them fruit, but I'm sure the birds do. J for the sweet russet jargonelle pear, which on shelves in the storeroom is laid up with care. K for the kernel that pays us so well for the trouble we've taken to open the shell. L is the fragrant and pale-colored lime, growing ripe in the sun of a tropical clime. M for the melon, the French woman sells by the arch within sound of the old minster bells. N is the nectarine kind Jenny took to the sick girl who lived by the side of the brook. O is for orange, so juicy and sweet, which Ellen has brought for the baby to eat. P for the peaches, which little Anne's ball, to old William's dismay, has struck down from the wall. Q for the quince, growing down in the glade, of which Sarah the cook will make nice marmalade. R for the raspberries, gathered at dawn, for the school children's tea, by and by on the lawn. S is for strawberry, brilliant and red, which we look for amongst the green leaves of its bed. T for the tamarinds, brought from the west, with ginger and guava in mariner's chest. U and V have no fruit, but the grape-bearing vine grows in Italy, Spain, and beside the swift Rhine. W for the walnuts at Christmas we eat, and make of the shells such a capital fleet. XYZ I must leave, but you may, if you please, call them fruit in the guise of unknown quantities. End of the Fruit Alphabet, read by Denis Sayers in Modesto, California, for LibriVox, Fall 2008.
An Alphabet of Celebrities. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recorded by Laurie Ann Walden. An Alphabet of Celebrities by Oliver Herford. A's Albert Edward, well-meaning but flighty, who invited King Arthur, the blameless and mighty, to meet Alcibiades and Aphrodite. B is for Bernhardt, who fails to awaken much feeling in Bismarck, Barabbas, and Bacon. C is Columbus, who tries to explain how to balance an egg to the utter disdain of Confucius, Carlyle, Cleopatra, and Cain. D's for Diogenes, Darwin, and Dante, who delight in the dance of a darling Bacchante. E is for Edison, making believe he's invented a clever contrivance for Eve, who complained that she never could laugh in her sleeve. F is for Franklin, who fearfully shocks the feelings of Fenelon, Faber, and Fox. G is Godiva, whose great bareback feat she kindly but firmly declines to repeat, though Gounod and Goldsmith implore and entreat. H is for Handel, who pours out his soul through the bagpipes to Howells and Homer, who roll on the floor in an ecstasy past all control. I is for Ibsen, reciting a play while Irving and Ingersoll hasten away. J is for Johnson, who only says pish to Jonah, who tells him his tale of a fish. K is the Kaiser, who kindly repeats some original verses to Kipling and Keats. L is La Fontaine, who finds he's unable to interest Luther and Liszt in his fable, while Loewy continues to dance on the table. M is Macduff, who's prevailed upon Milton and Montaigne and Manon to each try a kill tone. N is Napoleon, shrouded in gloom with Nero, Narcissus, and Nordau, to whom he's explaining the manual of arms with a broom. O is for Oliver, casting aspersion on Omar, that awfully dissolute Persian, though secretly longing to join the diversion. P is for Peter, who hollers no, no, through the keyhole to Payne, Paderewski, and Poe. Q is the Queen, so noble and free. For further particulars, look under V. R is Rubinstein, playing that old thing in F, to Rollo and Rembrandt, who wish they were deaf. S is for Swinburne, who, seeking the true, the good, and the beautiful, visits the zoo, where he chances on Sappho and Mr. Sardou, and Socrates, all with the same end in view. T is for Talleyrand, toasting Miss Truth by the side of her well in a glass of vermouth, and presenting Mark Twain as the friend of his youth. U is for Undine, pursuing Ulysses and Umberto, who flee her damp, death-dealing kisses. V is Victoria, noble and true. For further particulars, look under Q. W's Wagner, who sang and played lots for Washington, Wesley, and good Dr. Watts. His prurient plots pained Wesley and Watts, but Washington said he enjoyed them in spots. X is Xantippe, who's having her say and frightening the army of Xerxes away. Y is for Young, the great Mormon saint, who thinks little Yum-Yum and Yvette so quaint, he has to be instantly held in restraint. Z is for Zola, presenting La Terre to Zenobia the brave and Zuleika the fair, whose blushes they artfully conceal with their hair. End of An Alphabet of Celebrities. ABC of the Apple Pie. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org.
Recorded by Aaron Walbert and his mom. ABC of the Apple Pie.
Author unknown.
ABC. A was once an apple pie. B bit it. C cut it. D E F. D divided it. E eat it. F fought for it. G H I J. G got it. H had it. I and J jumped for it. K L M. K kept it. L longed for it. M mourned for it. N O P. N nodded at it. O opened it. P peeped into it. Q R S. Q quartered it. R ran for it. S stole it. T U V W. T took it. U and V viewed it. W wanted it. X, Y, and Z. X, Y, Z.
And ampersand.
Always for a piece in hand.
End of Alphabet of the Apple Pie.
Aunt Louisa's London Alphabet by an unknown author. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Logan McCammon. Aunt Louisa's London Alphabet by an unknown author. Apple Stall. The apple stall stands at the end of the street, with piles of ripe apples, bright, rosy, and sweet. Old Sarah is honest and civil to all. So, Arthur, my dear, we will buy at her stall.
Bazaar.
The bazaar is full of such beautiful things, of dolls, carts, and horses, and toys upon strings. The children are puzzled to know what to buy, and George at its wonders does nothing but pry.
Cabman. We have lost our way, Sister Mary and I. So, good Mr. Cabman, we beg you will try. And carry us home, if you wish to know where. 'Tis the corner house of a very fine square.
Dustmen. We are only poor dustmen of this great town. On our labor people are apt to look down. But if nobody carried the rubbish away, I think very few in the city could stay.
Engine. Here comes the great fire engine rushing along, with seven brave firemen, bold, daring, and strong. The smoke rises thickly, the sky is quite red. If they don't put it out soon, the fire will spread.
Fog. There's a yellow fog in the city today. We can scarcely see there an inch of our way.
But the little link boy will lend us his light, and led puzzled people all through it quite right. Guns. Bang! Go the guns with a terrible noise, but they do not frighten brave little boys. And Johnny would wish for no better fun than to try if he couldn't fire off a gun. Horse guards. The horse guards are coming, I see the shine of their swords as they trot in stately line. In war they fight bravely, as people know, who remember the great war long ago. Idlers. These idlers who loiter about all day are quite a disgrace to the Queen's highway, for laziness only has made them poor and reduced them to beg from door to door. Jail. The jail too often becomes the last home of beggars who through the streets idly roam, for that idle hands find mischief to do is a proverb found to be always true. King William's statue. King William's statue looks calmly down on the busiest street of this great town, where all is hurry and bustle and noise of men and women, carts, horses, and boys. Lamplighter. The lamplighter hastens the gas to light, that streets may be cheerful and safe at night. How pretty in a long twinkling line, growing smaller and smaller, the bright lamps shine. Monument. The monument stands on the very spot where the great fire, never to be forgot, broke out in the days when gay Charles was king and burnt and destroyed almost everything. Newsboy. The newsboy, though little, does a good trade. Morning and evening his pennies are made. The Times and the Standard you hear him cry, or Daily Telegraph, which will you buy? Omnibus. Omnibus, ma'am, just a-going to the zoo. There's room inside for the children and you. Step in, if you please, miss, we cannot wait. We will set you down quite close to the gate. Punch. Our friends Punch and Toby displays their feats at the corner of many London streets. The tricks of the puppets all of us know, yet we always laugh at the funny show. Queen. Queen Victoria now sits on the throne, a better queen England never has known. Though the nation owed much, we must confess, to the brave, wise rule of our good Queen Bess. River. The river. The river sparkles and plays, as if it rejoiced in the sun's bright rays. Mama, if you love your little daughter, please let me go on the shining water. Steamer. The steamer puffs at a long cloud of steam as it cuts its way through the rippling stream. Mama dear, I wonder how I should feel if I were the man who stands by the wheel. Tower. The Tower of London is dark, gray, and old. Sad tales of its dismal towers are told. The two little princes in it were slain, that cruel King Richard III might reign.
Underground Railway.
Into the darkness and out of the light, the underground railway carries us quite. They have taken a lesson from the moles and burrow like them in underground holes. Volunteers, Westminster. The brave volunteers in St. James Park go to drill in the evening before it is dark, past the Parliament houses at Westminster, where the Lords and the Commons make laws just and fair. X, Y. These are policemen, their numbers X, Y. How that boy laughs as he sees them march by. If they should look around, away he would run. Though he is not naughty, 'tis only fun. Zoological Gardens. The zoological gardens today are full of happy young creatures at play. But the tiger seems thinking, what a treat such nice little morsels would be to eat.
End of Aunt Louise's London Alphabet. Recording by Logan McCammon.
Baseball ABC by an unknown author. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Baseball ABC by an unknown author. A stands for Arthur, a boy fond of fun. When baseball he plays, none like him can run. B stands for ball, for bat and for base. C stands for catcher, with mask on his face. D stands for a diamond, drawn flat on the ground. E stands for Edward, who marks out the bound. F stands for foul, on which Arthur goes out. G stands for go, how the merry boys shout. H stands for highball, knocked up to the sky. I stands for innings, for which we all try. J stands for judgment, the base keeper's shout. K stands for Carl, who so quickly gets out. L stands for left field, who catches fly balls. M stands for muff, who cannot catch at all. N stands for Norman, who knocks the ball high. O stands for out, when it's caught on the fly. P stands for pitcher, a smart boy, you see. Q stands for quick, which this pitcher must be. R stands for runner, who runs to each base. S stands for shortstop, the ball he must chase. T stands for third base, looked after by James. U stands for umpire, who judges these games. V stands for Victor, the best of the nine. W stands for William, who tells us the time. X stands for score mark, which errors point out. Y stands for youth, who's been injured no doubt. Z stands for Zeno, this boy rather tall, who thinks there's no fun like a game of baseball. End of Baseball ABC. Recording by Logan McCammon.
The Doings of the Alphabet. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, visit LibriVox.org. The Doings of the Alphabet by an Unknown Author. The 26 Letters on Pleasure Intent at Alphabet House, a Day's Holiday Spent. Observe now and see in what order they went. First came Captain A, with B, C, D, and E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, and P, then queer little Q, and then R, S, T. Next, U, V, and W went on their way. X, Y, and Z stopped with each other to play. And now, all their names, little friend, can you say? S-H-O-U-T, with delight, gave a shout. As brimful of frolic, they scampered about, and sought for amusement within doors and out. Doings of the Alphabet. A, in the garden, a large apple found. Ripe, red, and mellow, it lay on the ground. He divided it first, then handed it round. B watched the bees all the summer day long, busy the sweet-scented flowers among, filling the air with their soft, droning song. C stroked the cat as it slept in the sun. Good boys never sleep till their lessons are done. But Puss is but Puss, and so tasks she has none. D called the dog. In his kennel he lay, but readily came at the summons to play. Are we always willing and quick to obey? E went for eggs, and was highly pleased when she spied out the nest of an old speckled hen, who had filled it with eggs, to the number of 10. F fed the fowls. How delighted they came, so greedy for food. It would fill me with shame if children, forgetting themselves, did the same. G heard a goat bleat, and turning round, old Billy the goat in the garden he found, but Billy kicked up and was off with a bound. H saw the horse, and he asked leave to ride. Honest Hanks, with good humor, soon set him astride, and through the green meadows kept close to his side. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, and Z. I plucked the ivy, which round the tree twined. J, with a jump and a laugh, went to find a blue jay, which sung in the thicket behind. K saw the kine, which are cows, and soon learned how curds from the milk into cheese could be turned, and cream into butter, if properly churned. L loved the lambs. Soft and harmless were they. How pretty they looked at their innocent play, as nimbly they capered through all the long day. M found a mole, who, though not very bright, worked far underground, where it always is night, much better than many who work in the light. N and O, for dessert, nuts and oranges sought. O, when asked to take more, had enough, as she thought, and said, "No, I thank you," as little folks ought. P heard the parrot say, "How do you do?" and then said, "I'm wiser, Miss Polly, than you, for the words and their meaning right well I know, too." Q, looking round, saw some quince in a jar. R prudently said, "Now, if honest we are, let us leave it alone. 'Twill be better by far." S found the scriptures. How happy was she to read the sweet words from the book on her knee, "Suffer little children to come unto me." T asked the time, for soon home they must go. Swiftly the pendulum moves to and fro. Time waits for no one, as wise people know. U, who was useful to help and to learn, ran to the kitchen and brought in the urn, then served them to tea and to plum cake in turn. V, from the vine, gathered grapes for a treat. W walked on the large wagon to meet, and soon, full of fun, every one took a seat. X, Y, and Z were so sorry that they had found little to see, to hear, or to say, but hoped to do better the next holiday. End of the Doings of the Alphabet. Read by Denny Sayers in Modesto, California, for LibriVox, Fall 2008.